We are African, and we happen to be in America. We're not American. We are people who formerly were Africans who were kidnapped and brought to America.
Good evening. Dr. Martin Luther King, the apostle of nonviolence in the civil rights movement, has been shot to death in Memphis, Tennessee.
Today, at these very Capitol steps, the Commonwealth of Kentucky will commemorate the 50th anniversary march on Frankfort. Now, in 1964, they marched for the passage of a public accommodations bill that would prohibit segregation and discrimination in businesses, restaurants, stores, and theaters. That march provided the impetus for the eventual passage of Kentucky's 1966 Civil Rights Act. You see, throughout the history of the modern world, including the civil rights movement right here in the state of Kentucky and the United States, marching has always represented a primary mechanism for the facilitation of collective resistance. As a participatory act, this act of peaceful protest galvanizes people from disparate social, economic, and racial backgrounds into a cohesive form of solidarity. Now, more often, this act of solidarity is the only means of demonstrating intolerance for unjust laws and practices that would deny civil rights to some in favor of others. That denial represents nothing short of oppression and abasement, and it refuses citizens access to the most fundamental rights of citizenry and democracy. So today, as we celebrate the gains attained in equality by the courageous acts of those participants some 50 years ago, perhaps we should reflect on the current conditions of abasement and oppression that remain entrenched in our 21st century society, and reconfirm our obligation and responsibility to extend the mantle of equality to an ever new and emerging generation. In no other way can we honor the courageous contributions and accomplishments of that 1964 event. So today, as thousands gather here in Kentucky's state capitol, they gather not only to commemorate that momentous event, but also to reconfirm a commitment to the basic ideals of human and civil rights. And these are their voices.
NAACP in Frankfort, to a large extent led by Helen Holmes, had started the movement in Frankfort that culminated in a march on Frankfort before 1964. It was composed of faculty and staff members at Kentucky State, community members, many of them belonging to NAACP. During that same period of time, of course, when we began to think of Temple Sit-Ins, Corps came in to conduct training sessions as to how the person sitting in should be able to respond, I should say not respond, and the ability to endure the indignities that were heaped on them while they were sitting in.
Because everybody is this crippled, you know, can't make it in. Never have your seat if you ever get up, girl.
Justice and equality crosses all lines, racial, economic, social, religious. As human beings have found a method of protest in which they can articulate their frustrations with current conditions, not only in society, but in the entire world.
Over every change.
most of them were held either at St. John's AME Church or at Jack Robb's funeral home. The students really were the ones who did most of the sitting in, for example, at Frisch's restaurant, East Main Street. A lot of the dirty work had already been done before 1964. The participants in the sit-ins, the petitions to the business establishment, because people normally think of restaurants.
It's important to remember that throughout the history of the civil rights movement, marching has been a critical, important means of social protest. This act of peaceful protest presents a united front as people from all and different aspects of life get together to voice their opinions or their frustrations over a condition of abasement or oppression. Now, this act of solidarity demonstrates an intolerance for injustice, no matter where it may occur. And it crosses the lines and demarcations of race, class, gender, socioeconomic group, and or political affiliation.
The music, of course, that we were familiar with was We Shall Overcome. We would share in that and just come out with it a little bit. And of course, we sang it as we all gathered together. But it was a time when we just basically were not sure what was going to happen. So it was one of those ways of unifying a very disparate group. And we were all there for a cause, but the causes were different because some of us were white, of course, and some were black.
Before the march started, there was a list of the names of people who were supposed to be in the front row marching, obviously in the center of the first row, Martin Luther King and Jack Robinson. And by the time for the march to start, I saw people, of course, rushing to get in the front part of the line who really were not scheduled to be there. So I would say that if there were any academy awards to be given for the civil rights movement in Frankfort, it would have gone to people like Helen Holmes. If you had asked me who else was the leader other than her, the leader as far as the thing is concerned, I would be hard put to name someone. She had a lot of people helping her, of course, but we looked to her as the leader. And she happened to be in a very unique situation that some people were not in. She had her own economic security. At Kentucky State, a lot of the factory men people were afraid to participate because it means that you could have lost your job through participation in the movement. That pressure was there from the white community, and to an extent, some took an economic risk in spite of Frankfort community, in spite of the potential repercussions that they could have faced.
Now, there's little doubt that those participants in the march 50 years ago would celebrate the grounds that have been gained since that time. Nevertheless, as we reflect on those gains, it's important that we also reflect on the challenges that remain and unanimously conclude that it is our responsibility to pick up that torch that was so ably passed on 50 years ago. We're here on this day to commemorate the 50th anniversary of the mass march on Frankfort, Kentucky. Remember that oppression manifests itself in such ways that it denies things such as voter participation or voter rights. But even more and more critical, oppression and abasement denies one the right to be a human being.
Usually, we don't include in that fight the right for African-American women. You were black women, you probably Negro women at that time, to be able to go into a department store and try a dress on or try a hat on. So there was as much discrimination in those type of establishments as there were in restaurants and in hotels.
Anytime we can verbalize a conviction, it crystallizes it in our mind and gives us the foundation for implementing it with action and with words. So songs and phrases and mottos are means to that end. Now the shortcoming of that is if we just stop there, we never move to actualizing and bringing to fruition what the word, the motto, the songs are saying. We have to get to the point where we can understand why we have not overcome and deal with those things in terms of concrete proposals, corralled with people who you have convinced of the merit of it, and together we can move another notch forward.
To me, the heroes of that period were those people who were working in the trenches in the early 60s, prior to 64. By the time of Martin Luther King March in 1964, some of the walls in Frankfort had already begun to rumble. And by 64, it became fairly fashionable for people to join the movement. Of course, the march on Frankfort in 64 was a statewide march, and it was coordinated by leaders throughout the state. A lot of logistics had to be taken care of at that time. You had the local police there, state troopers were there, and the FBI was there. In my role as a marshal, I had the naive assumption that part of my job was to protect King. When I got up to the platform, and I saw these two white men standing on each side of King, and I said, better keep my eye on them. And I went and talked to the Franklin policeman. I said, you better check this man out, standing right behind King. He said, Dr. Ridgel, he's an FBI agent. I don't know about this.
So today's march essentially represents an opportunity and responsibility to build on that legacy established 50 years ago. The thousands of participants here today are united, and they march for those rights that we often take for granted but are denied by others, such as the right to vote, the right to sexual identity. So while 50 years ago it was about voting rights and public accommodations, today it's about the restoration of voting rights and the elimination of all attempts to suppress those rights.